the BBC referred to me when I put on a hijab. The BBC referred to me as the former journalist Yvonne Ridley. The plight of the Palestinians, it doesn't matter whether you're a person of faith or no faith, this is one of the biggest, longest running injustices in the world. Do you think that we'll end up in paradise if we die here? And he said, well, yes, he said, I can't think of a more noble cause than dying for the Palestinians. And it was just around the time, Ramadan was a few months away, and I was so...
So that was to be your first Ramadan?
That was where I had my first Ramadan, and I was so blessed and lucky to be in a Muslim country that isn't afraid to wear its faith on its sleeve, you know, it was
so the
wonderful.
Fact that you moved to an Arab country made it probably easy for you in the post-conversion era, because you were well known. I mean, you were in the media, people knew you. So probably your conversion would have caused a stir, wouldn't it?
Yes. So it was so much easier going to live and work in a Muslim country and learn more about the faith, which, as I say, is a way of life. It's not just something that you put on Friday prayers and then forget about for the next 7 days.
Any backlash from your old friends or your old colleagues?
Yes. I mean, some old friends and old colleagues are no longer old friends. You know, they have just... not answered my calls or ignored emails, or if they see me, they look the other way. But essentially, I'm still the same person, still have the same sense of humour. And the friends who've stayed with me, have total respect for the faith.
How about the Muslim community in the UK?
Wonderful, absolutely wonderful. People of all cultures and backgrounds have really welcomed me into the Muslim community, especially the women. And you know that this is something that I often talk about when I'm addressing women's groups. I'll say, before I was a Muslim, I would have walked into this room and seen those of you wearing the hijabs and thinking, oh, you poor, oppressed women. And I said, now I walk into a room full of Muslim women and I'm trying to work out who's the engineer, who's the doctor, who's the psychologist, who's got this profession, who's the backbone of the community. And I said, and you're all mothers. And so proud to be a mother, whereas the status of being a mother in the non-Muslim community is quite different.
Now, how about the community of Muslim converts? Because I hear from some of them that a while after conversion, they feel lonely. To what degree is that loneliness?
It can be a lonely existence. But it's something that I'm not entirely convinced about, because I used to hate my own company before I converted to Islam. You know, I was forever at the center of the parties and always surrounded by people and always out. But once I converted to Islam, I developed a peace that I hadn't known before. And I actually now enjoy my own company and enjoy sitting down and reading. But I can understand the loneliness, because when you convert and the community embraces you, you do become the center of attention and everybody loves you and everybody wants you to do so well, and then life kicks in people get involved with their own problems. And because converts aren't part of a big family and quite often abandoned by their own family, they can often feel isolated. And so I can see how it could be tough. It wasn't for me. I actually started to learn to like myself and to have self-respect and self-esteem, which is very important. And I realized before that I didn't have that self-esteem.
Any challenges on the professional level? I mean, you were working in the mainstream media before, but now that you've chosen this journey, things are not the same, are they?
No, I was dropped like a hot brick. The BBC referred to me when I put on a hijab. The BBC referred to me as the former journalist Yvonne Ridley,
and I, as if you are no longer.
Yeah, it took many letters and various complaints to different departments to say, I am still working as a journalist. How dare you call me the former journalist? And it had been quite difficult, but people are slowly coming around to seeing that I'm still professional. I still care about journalism, I've changed the style of journalism that I do. I used to do a lot of undercover work, but now I focus mainly on humanitarian efforts. And I still go out into war and conflict zones. And
you told me before we earlier that you've just been to Idlib.
Yes. Yes, that was quite a tough experience. People there are, you know, this expression, hang on to the rope or hold tight onto the rope of Allah. The people there, they have nothing left but God. And it is their faith which is keeping them going. And to secularists and atheists, you know, I would say, if you don't understand belief, go to Idlib and you will see God is everywhere, because that is what is keeping those people going.
Now, in addition to your conversion to Islam, you opposed the war in Iraq and you stood by the Palestinian people. And these two issues were also sources of trouble.
Well, I have been a staunch supporter of the Palestinians since I was 13, 14, when I first signed a petition, when I first heard about the Palestinians. And I've always been quite vocal about support for the Palestinians, and nobody really took any notice. And then the moment I put on a hijab, oh my word, she's an extremist. I said, but hold on, I had these views before. It's not me that's changed, it's you that's changed towards me. And the plight of the Palestinians It doesn't matter whether you're a person of faith or no faith. This is one of the biggest, longest running injustices in the world today. And it blighted the 20th century, and it's running into the 21st century. And it is a real big stain from east to west on our civilization. And, you know, people talk about the siege of Gaza being 12 years. I was on the very first boat to break the siege of Gaza, and about 100,000 Palestinians turned out to see the boats arrive. Why did so many people turn out? Because there hadn't been a boat arriving in Gaza for more than 40 years. This was incredible. And, you know, at the boats, there were two boats, largely crewed by non-Muslims, a lot of secularists and atheists. And at one point during the dead of night, we were told that we were surrounded by Israeli gunboats. And we thought, you know, this is the end. Our communications were down. All the cell phones, mobile phones, everything was down. We were in the pitch black, bobbling around in the eastern Mediterranean. And I was with filmmaker Aki Nawaz, who is a practicing Muslim. And I said, it looks as though this is the
end.
The end. And I said, do you think that we'll end up in paradise if we die here? And he said, well, yes, he said, I can't think of a more noble cause than dying for the Palestinians. And I said, you know, I said, you're right. And we both started laughing and at the irony that we were going to be sent to paradise by the Israelis, you know. And so we were laughing and saying, well, bring it on. And that belief in God just made us feel so strong. And
it does miracles.
It really, everybody else was, you know, you could see the fear, and they're looking at us thinking, what are those two daft Muslims laughing about? And it was because we were expecting any minute that that would be the end of this life, but greater things to come.
Did you end up with a Palestinian passport?
I did. I did. It was a miracle. For some reason, the Israeli boats just disappeared and we were able to continue on our journey. We got into Gaza and there were these banners with our faces everywhere. And I just thought, they didn't think we were going to get through. Yeah. These aren't the banners of welcome. These are the martyrs. And so I think a lot of people thought that we were going to be...
If I remember correctly, nobody ever made it after you. I think all the other boats were turned down, turned back, and or were arrested.
I think a couple did get through after that, but then there were... There was the Mavi Marmara and the Flotilla crimes, and it was nobody has been able to get through since, and it was that is probably one of the highlights of my life. And if ever my faith and belief in God was tested, and I think I passed 100%, was that moment on the boat. But after that, we met Ismail Haniyeh, who was then the Prime Minister in Gaza. And he issued us with passports. And I remember saying, at last, I have a prime minister of whom I can be proud. And that was a great moment as well.
And, a very good note to end on.